Very well.
Hello, and welcome, I hope, to the Multicast Show. I don't know if this is working or not. This is all very, very last minute because someone decides to get out of bed a bit too late. I'm Ben Allen, and joining me is my esteemed co-host, Mr. Reese Milling.
Hello, everyone. I'm Reese. Very bad sleep schedule, but yeah. And also, you can see how atrocious the room state is as well, which isn't ideal.
Yeah, we did promise to try and be slightly more sort of prepared with this whole thing, and then someone decides to overcomplicate things, and then it suddenly switched to me having to host this. We'll gloss over that just a little bit.
It's just the wise to be stream infrastructure. It's not the most ideal of states right now.
Yes, it's the wise TV streaming infrastructure that's the issue here. Yes, you're watching the Multicast Show where the liquor is smooth and the transitions are smoother. What was the first thing you wanted to talk about, Reese?
Shall we talk about the fantastic new Apple laptop that was released?
Oh, go on then.
Oh, because obviously Apple did have a nice little keynote recently, probably 2 weeks ago, so we're a bit late to the actual punch here. But they've actually got the new Apple M1 chip, which does look absolutely fantastic, and it is convincing a lot of people. What are your thoughts on it then, Ben, the fantastic chip?
I mean, honestly, I'm almost tempted to transition across. Jump back a couple of months, I never thought there was a chance in hell I'd ever be switching to Apple. In terms of machines that I daily drive, I've been Windows my whole life, and as much as I've enjoyed like the Apple machines that I've worked with, because I do a lot of audio stuff, the fact the audio drivers on them are Apple audio drivers are something else. As much as I've sort of enjoyed that, I've kind of always thought that the power's been a bit lackluster because they always sort of tend to prioritize like nice and thin and light over any actual sort of cooling performance, and we've seen that with a lot with certainly the Intel MacBooks that have come out. They've been hot, we'll go with that. We'll leave it there. They've been hot boys. Now things are coming out, and now that the performance actually looks pretty damn good, so even just for emulated x86 like stuff, I'm almost tempted. I'm very tempted. Reese, what are your thoughts?
Oh, I've been wooed by it as well as the issue. I mean, the biggest issues for me, I would say, is lack of I/O, because they've reduced it down to two Type-C ports. But mind you, I think they used to be 4.0, which I think the previous one might have been just Thunderbolt. But
right, so this is the interesting bit. So USB 4.0 is effectively a clarification of...
the mess.
Yeah, basically, it's the mess that USB the USB sort of standard has got into. So USB 4.0 is effectively just Thunderbolt 3.
Oh, interesting.
It's pretty much just the difference in branding, possibly, or I think also technically in the standard, but in terms of their like technical capabilities, I think it's pretty much the same. And particularly now that Intel's sort of opened up all this. All the Thunderbolt sort of branding and stuff to other like third parties. It'll be interesting. I mean, I'm trying to remember where it was. There was a nice, because the thing that I'm sort of, or that a lot of people have been very interested in for, and like where I've seen lots and lots of the comparisons online for this M1 chip is for video editors. So,
how does it perform? I mean, they did say about, ProRes, but obviously ProRes, there's not much to actually process.
Yes, I was just trying to figure out where is the video encoding table? I'm just trying to Google it. Because, yeah, there was a nice comparison table to show you exactly sort of what it did and didn't support.
Yeah, so whilst you look for that, there's also another issue I did have with it, but I think it might be getting resolved by the community. It was the lack of virtualization, because I do enjoy a Linux machine, and just like having like in Windows, a Windows subsystem for Linux, that's fantastic. And I have heard that people have been able to get Qt, I can't remember to fully pronounce it. It's Qemu. Q-E-M-U. Hopefully that is correct.
Well, we'll see.
Yeah, but it looks like people have been able to at least... I've seen people virtualize Windows, so I presume Linux is also working. Obviously, it's the ARM variant, but still, it's fantastic to actually see that we've got virtualization, because it's making it a lot more of a sweeter sell for me now. But still, yeah. I don't know. It's just that limited I/O as well, but mind you...
The limited I/O is probably one of the few things that's still sort of holding me back from it, because other than that, it does look very interesting.
It does. But I've heard also that they're going to have like a little refresh, hopefully. Not so much a refresh, but they're going to have a 15-inch MacBook Pro.
Yes, so that room on the rumor mill, that's supposed to be coming out at some point. I think early 2021 is what people are hoping. And yeah, that we don't know yet if it's going to be the M2 or the M1X or exactly how they're going to distinguish it. But I think currently what we've heard is, I think it might be 8 performance cores and 4 of the efficiency cores. So it would be effectively a 12 core I think the quoted thing on the rumor mill was 8 Firestorm and 4 Ice Storm. Actually, I think the names of the cores, I think, off the top of my head. This is remembering stuff from articles that I read way, way back. This is...
Yeah, it'd help if we actually used up-to-date news instead.
Yeah, I was just trying to see if I could find... Because I think it was on Slack, I found a nice little table showing exactly what capabilities it did and didn't have on the video end.
Also, a little bit of we've got one comment. Well, not actually, we do actually have a comment. It's from Mr. Wardle. The hell are you Muppets doing?
That's a very valid question, I suppose.
We have also another question coming in. What is this from Jonathan Hughes?
I mean, to be fair, I'm sincerely hoping that you've actually cleared it with all the appropriate channels, because I'm very much taking your word on this.
I approved it with Carolyn, who, for people who don't know, is the production director. So it was production team approved. But the issue is that it wasn't very much approved by anyone else. We luckily got the comp team to sign off on it somehow.
Oh, interesting. I wonder how that happened. That's one of life's mysteries, I suppose.
Indeed.
But yeah, I think off the top of my head, the M1 chip supported hardware decoding, I think possibly for AV1 as well, which was one of the more interesting features.
Did they?
It'd
be nice to see AV1 finally get a bit more. Mind you, it's been quite popular on like mobile chips altogether, I think. It's laying on newer handsets, but it's like just desktop and laptops is where it's been lacking, I suppose. And it's been more...
Yeah.
The GPU that has been an
issue up until then. Because, yeah, I suppose that's been one of the main issues with adoption is the fact that it's still quite tricky to actually use, like, at all. Right, according to... I've no idea how much of a reputable source this is, but according to CPU Monkey, which we can, I think, switch to... Yes, although I did realize that actually I haven't put our microphones in, so that's also something.
Yeah.
Let me just throw in a browser source here. Oh, dear.
Dear.
Also, a big shout out to a certain assistant head of computing for assistant computing director is the title of YSTV. I forgot about that. Because we're using his OBS presets.
Oh, yes.
Slightly modified.
Working a charm. Except for the other aspects, which we are just failing at.
Yes, that is a bit of an issue. Right, if we switch over, right, here we go. So according to CPUMonkey.com, it's got H.264 decode and encode. It's got HEVC 8-bit and 10-bit decode and encode. Same for VP8, VP9. AV1 is only decoding. VC1 is only decoding. And AVC, interestingly, is decode.
Interesting.
It also has apparently JPEG decode and encode as well.
That is peculiar. I mean,
which is very interesting.
You could have just done that on the CPU, but
it depends because I don't know. Like this,
It's not like my video through JPEG. Yeah. Because you use MJPEG, but
let's see. I think it's more for things like trying to accelerate video image processing and stuff like that. I think it's just part of the sort of image processing suite of stuff that they've tried to build onto the chip. Because I suppose that is the big advantage of this whole thing. It's the fact that actually now that it's a more integrated system, they can kind of, I don't know, they can try and build on more power.
Yeah, they're quite like flexible.
That's the thing. I mean, the traditional sort of thing has been just, okay, if we throw as many, like, as much raw CPU horsepower as something as possible, then we can try and get it done that way. Whereas Apple's going with a lot more sort of specialist hardware for each different task that you might want to do.
Mm.
And obviously with more demanding things like video, that works quite well because it's seemingly in all the video like benchmarks and stuff that I've seen creators doing on YouTube, in pretty much every single program, it seems to be either keeping pace with the last Intel crop of MacBooks or like flooring them, depending on whether things are ARM optimized or not. So DaVinci Resolve has got a beta with the sort of, because Apple are now distributing programs in a slightly more interesting way. So they've got this universal binary thing where they've got both x86 code and ARM code in like one sort of executable, which you just sort of download and run, and it sort of, it figures everything out in the background. And the universal binary version of this beta of Resolve apparently is performing live really nicely. So that's at least promising.
Mm.
It'll be interesting to see what happens from there. And obviously Final Cut in Apple's typical fashion is optimized beyond belief. So that's pretty damn speedy as well.
Yeah, that's
It is a shame to see that Adobe haven't really been able to sort of push the boat out with like their ARM support as of yet. They've been much slower to the punch.
Yeah, I've heard Photoshop support is there, but still.
Is it Photoshop or Lightroom? One of them is currently in beta.
Oh, it might be in that, yeah.
Adobe ARM.
But yeah, it's just a shame of like just Adobe things attempt to. It might be because like Resolve now, for example, it's already built for like three different platforms. So I feel like the code base might be a bit more better than whatever Adobe's using. But obviously, haven't had a look at both code bases as an issue.
Yeah, it's.
And also a bit of trivia as well is that apparently, well, YouTube is telling us off because we are not given we don't have fast enough group of frames, or, well, our group of frame length is too long. Currently it is 10 seconds, and they recommend 4 seconds or less. For the fans who don't.
Right, let's see if I can do that on the fly. I'm hoping that might have possibly switched. We'll need to see. No idea.
What, you can switch what your group of frame interval is? Oh, I mean,
possibly.
I mean, it is. You can make it dynamic, I know, but I haven't seen it for live.
Well, because with OBS, seemingly you can change the video bitrate on the fly. So
really?
I think so, yeah.
Could have sworn you had to restart the stream, but yeah, fingers are crossed. Hopefully we can get past stream status quo.
Yeah. Let me know if that changes, because that would be interesting to find out.
Mm.
So yeah, that's what is. We did get a comment earlier from a certain Jonathan Hughes asking what this is, and honestly, the jury's kind of out. Also, your room's looking a bit messy there, Reese.
Yeah.
Right. So what this is, I don't know. It's kind of a bit. So on ULY, they've got Computing.do Radio Show, which is kind of their computing team's like general sort of technical talking thing. And I guess that's kind of what this is. It's sort of like generally just sort of talking about the technical space, but in the world of video. And just general sort of tech stuff as well. So I don't know. I don't really know what this is. It's more just we talk about stuff that we're interested in, see what happens. There are no guarantees in terms of quality. If you're here for that, I'm afraid you're going to be sorely disappointed. But we can try and at least stay semi-interesting to people who are also video nerds. And
yeah,
that's kind of it.
I will try and be on time next time for this release and actually advertise it beforehand.
Oh, I don't think we need to advertise this. It's a mixture of parents watching, and also just I'm really not sure it's worth scaring people off of our socials for this.
True, possibly.
it's a fairly niche viewer base that are going to be interested in this sort of stuff. Yeah, anyway, you were going to give a good description of what the group of pictures is, so feel free to go ahead with that.
I'm going to get harassed for getting this wrong. But
absolutely.
Essentially, the way modern video works is that, obviously, you can't send the raw camera signal because it's just so much data. We're talking, like, gigabits of data. And obviously, we want to be able to work with, like, 8 megabits, 4 megabits, like, obviously, just miniature fraction. And so we do this by just doing a lot of tricks. So one thing is to do is you essentially take that video feed and you put it into keyframes. And these keyframes will just be a snapshot of that video stream every couple of seconds. In our scenario, we're still using 10 seconds, sadly. And essentially, but you might be wondering, well, what's it going to do for that little gap in between? But essentially, it has these other frames which are predictive, and they're based on the data from the previous frames. So for any little slight changes, it'll only store the changes, essentially, between each frame. So that you don't need to actually regenerate the frame because you're just basing off the data you've already got, and allows you to make some fantastic data optimizations. And that's essentially what groups of frames is. So you've just got P frames. I think, is it B frames? Oh, see, I can't remember what all the
frames. I think it's P, B, and I, I believe.
Yes, because B is just like that. It's kind of like half like a full frame. And it's just used as a sense of quality, whilst iframes are the actual predictive ones, or is that the keyframes?
Right, so iframes are the least compressible.
That was it.
Then, what is it?
P-frames?
Yeah, that's it. Right, so I've just Googled it just to double check. So that's it, yeah. So as far as I can tell, I think iframes are the sort of ones at the very start. Then a P frame will use information from the previous frames to try and like sort of compress things, and that's kind of where it then gets the, well, like we're only showing the changes really sort of thing. And then B frames use both like both forward prediction and back prediction effectively. So that's the thing. So that's why they rely on the most amount of like data processing and compression effectively. So yeah, iframes are the ones at the very start, which have like an entire image. P then has like sort of little changes sort of along the way. And then the same with B, but they're just sort of, they use slightly different algorithms, I suppose, to try and optimize the data.
Yeah, and then it's quite useful to optimize because not everyone's got a gigabit connection sometimes. Yeah,
not everyone's living on university campus with lovely, lovely throughput speeds.
Menacing firewall, though, in my opinion. I do like TalkTalk, ultra fiber optic. Well, it's more York City Council have just got this little fiber scheme. Oh, gorgeous is what it is. I can tell Ben's thieving because he can't actually download Java. I think, yeah, you can't actually download Java directly, like Oracle.
What?
Like the proprietary version of Java, you can't download it. It'll literally just block you. That's what I tried to do. I think it's just... Well, you know, like, Oracle's a bloody pain. So I think...
Yeah.
It's just... I'm not entirely sure of the exact reason, but try and download Java on, like, your little desktop. See if you can actually get it to download.
Right, okay.
I mean, it's a bit off topic from video, but it's just firewalls. Very interesting stuff.
Right, can I download Java?
I think, yeah, just try and get off the Oracle site, not like OpenJDK or any of that business. Just
interesting, yeah, javadl.oracle.com server IP address could not be found.
Yeah, so literally just blocks you.
Curious.
That is peculiar, isn't it? One of the few things they do block. I mean, they're also notorious packet sniffers, so they're probably watching this stream right now from an unofficial source, which isn't good. You should all be watching at ycv.co.uk/live.
Or do it on YouTube, because that way you can actually comment about how much of a mess Reese's room is.
True. I think the site did used to have live comment functionality. Or it might still do, it's just we've not got it enabled, perhaps.
Oh, your audio's got a tad terminator.
Oh dear.
Yeah, you might want to... I don't even want to know. Right, what other topics have you got for us then?
I've got another little juicy topic here. It's is my microphone signal right now?
It'll do.
Dear.
But yeah, than my usual standard.
What's it gonna say? But yes, Nvidia, apparently the RTX 3060 leak has been, well, it's been leaked, essentially.
Oh, they're always being leaked. Graphics cards are like one of the most leakable forms of tech.
I'd say phones are worse.
Yeah, it's phones and then graphics cards, probably. Particularly at the moment with the massive, massive generational leaps that we've been having from, but to be fair, both AMD and Nvidia. Graphics cards seem to be the hot topic. And I mean, with all the sort of scalping and everything, and this like massive, massive stock shortages that have been going on, graphics cards seem to be sort of like the hot ticket item this Christmas. So it'll be interesting to see exactly what happens with that.
Yeah.
Especially after AMD made their sort of big sort of deal out of how they were going to. Oh, so yeah. So Nvidia launched their sort of, what was it? It was the 3090, 3080, and 3070. They then immediately all sold out everywhere, like across the internet. You couldn't get hold of them, and then the scalpers were going mad with that. And then off the back of that, AMD came out saying, "Oh, we're going to make sure we've got all these safeguards in place so that nothing as ridiculous as this could possibly happen to us." So then they launched their, what was it? Is it the 5000 series? I think.
I hear that name thrown about.
Oh, I get really lost in terms of the AMD naming schemes. But their latest generation, yeah, their competitive GPUs, and then the exact same thing happened. So it was even more embarrassing for them, because after seeing this, and then after putting up statements saying how, oh, there's no way this could possibly happen to us, we've done like all these great things, the exact same thing happened again. It's just like, it's not a great look.
No, it just seems, there's just such like a manufacturing shortage. It might be just COVID and also just,
I mean, yeah, there are manufacturing shortages, but it is also because there's been such a massive intergenerational leak, there are loads more people that are actually upgrading compared to last time. Because obviously there was, certainly on the Nvidia side, Nvidia's obviously sort of rule, like been sort of, I suppose, the king of the like GPU roost for a while now. So obviously with their, when they released their 2000 series, all the people that had the their 1000 series, because there wasn't that much of a massive like intergenerational leap between the two. Pretty much the only sort of new feature was ray tracing. In terms of actual like core performance, it didn't really go up by that much. So that just meant that there were lots of people that didn't really upgrade. And there were even people that sort of had like 9000 series, like sort of me, or sort of even ones before that, that took a look at the 2000 series, were like, actually, we don't really necessarily need that. So they either didn't bother upgrading at all, or they went for the 10,000 series, or for the, sorry, the 1,000 series, because that's now cheaper. So you've got all these people that are now sort of stuck pretty much on the 1,000 series or before, that never bothered going to 2,000. They're all suddenly deciding, oh, okay, this is a massive deal. We can upgrade. And even the people with the 2,000 series, actually, because of the massive leap, it's almost worth them upgrading if they have the money, because there is that big of a performance jump. It's insane.
Yeah.
So that means that pretty much everyone across the entire graphics card spectrum is eligible to upgrade. I say eligible. It's in a position where upgrading would be worthwhile to this new 3000 series. So pretty much the entirety of the PC gaming space, as like as well as like all creators, have suddenly just sat up with this launch and gone, oh, that looks nice. So yeah, no wonder they're in such ridiculous demand. And obviously, since AMD have come out with roughly competitive in terms of performance graphics cards, I think the majority of reviews are saying for gaming, actually, AMD is looking pretty good. But in terms of content creation, things sort of vary a little bit, just because there are so many features that are sort of built for sort of NVIDIA's CUDA architecture, which means that for content creation, actually, NVIDIA is still kind of the way to go. But obviously, that does depend a bit based on your workflow.
Indeed.
But that's why, yeah, NVIDIA's, yeah, that it'll be interesting trying to see when we can actually get hold of some of those latest gen cards, because yeah, they're very much out of stock at the moment on both sides, on both Team Green and Team Red.
Yeah, that's a pain. Oh dear, and also your Zoom feed, on a, wow, video link, it just, oh, you've just started artifacting for me.
That seems like a you internet issue, because yeah. I seem to be...
For some reason, your crispy. Hair's dyed.
Your what?
Your hair's gotten dyed, essentially.
Dyed to what?
It's like, you're looking like, well, you've got like some blue hair, you've got a little patch of green as well. I'll try and snap a picture. For the fans at home, obviously.
Please do. We've got a little behind-the-scenes moment.
Right. Excuse me just using the iPad, because my phone is actually out of charge.
Yes, and... it's a truly excellent manoeuvre.
Perfect. Right, I'll post it on Slack. Obviously, then you can share it if you want to.
Right.
Come on. Where are we? Right.
Stick it in the group with me and Dom as well.
So you can get the behind-the-scenes look as well. Fantastic. Because, yeah, we've got a nice exclusive group chat here. Right, that's uploading. Hopefully I don't peg my upload.
No, that's fine.
Oh, dear, now your headphones got really green. But, yeah, also, with NVIDIA, I find they also tend to change the definition of what a CUDA unit is from what I've heard online, which is a bit sketchy, but I don't know enough really to comment too much about it.
They do, quite possibly they do. It's, at the end of the day, it's more just that the general performance, like, based around that sort of architecture is actually quite good. It's less of a... Right, let me see.
Yeah, another thing also to consider is just, like, GPU miners as well. They're probably... It's not so much the latest... I'm not sure. Is the latest GPU good for mining? Maybe a question for the fans at home as well.
At that point, it would be a case of whichever's cheaper between NVIDIA and AMD, because one of the advantages of NVIDIA, I suppose, has been their sort of all their other features. So things like NVENC is, because I mean, as far as I can tell, I've never seen any sort of particularly good results for AMD's video encoding sort of onboard processing type thing. NVENC has been streets ahead for as long as I can possibly tell. Right. I think we can just about switch to Slack now. And yeah, there we go. There is
behind the scenes look.
Yeah, I don't quite know what's happened there, but thank God I don't actually look like that the rest of the time, because that.
Nice patch of green on your noggin. That's very. It's what the cool kids want these days. But yeah. I don't know. For this actual...
George has gone funny again.
Oh, for goodness sake. Yeah, next time I'll actually use an Ethernet connection instead of using bloody Wi-Fi. And there's literally like 30 other devices on, I'm pretty sure.
Oh, no.
I did actually count before. Yeah, 22 devices are on my Wi-Fi. Which isn't balanced, shall I say.
Yeah, it's not ideal. No. Yeah, right.
But also, yeah, the RTX 3060 Ti, it's been rumoured at a price about $400.
$400, what's that but in?
Obviously, you've got to add VAT to that, so I'm probably guessing about the same in price.
But 1.2.
What is?
So that'll be what, 480 USD ish, about 350 quid, including a 20% VAT.
That seems pretty decent, but still isn't much.
It's a little more expensive than the 60. Range was last gen, I think, wasn't it?
I think so. I've seen the lower end market is kind of disappearing in a way.
I mean, I think it's more just they're waiting to refresh stuff, because from what I can tell, the 16 series was incredibly popular on Nvidia's end, because it was just it had the typical non-ray tracing performance of their 2060 cards, but without the added price hike of chucking in, what's it called? RTX.
True.
So, I mean, certainly on the wireless TV end, we've been targeting a lot of our systems at the 1660 Super.
Yeah, because it does look like a fantastic card.
Because, yeah, I mean, that was one of the big step-ups, I suppose. This is why the 2000/16 series wasn't really worth it for most people. The advantage for streamers and people like us who deal with video things was mainly that with the Turing generation GPUs, their built-in video encoder got so much better. And NVENC was already better than AMD's video encoding offerings, but the Turing generation got so much better, and it's just...
Yeah, it's wiping the floor, if anything.
It's very nice. So that's why we're targeting most of our systems at that card, because...
It is quite good. I think you can do three jobs on it at a time? Did they have a limit?
So,
I think they did.
Yes, so the limit used to be two, and then I think it was a driver patch in June, they upped it to three, which goes to show that the entire thing is completely arbitrary. And you can also tell when you look at the performance monitoring of the cards on the video encode side. Like, even with three streams,
it still
uses about 15% of the video encoding capability. So it is a little irritating that Nvidia locks it down like that and sort of forces you to buy their more expensive Quadro cards to have like the unlocked thing. But actually, because it was the 400 that was the that I think was the lowest end one with the unlocked thing. But I don't know if they've actually changed that, because it was. I don't know if they've actually updated that to have the Turing generation of anything.
I haven't seen much of them doing much workstation wise this year. I think I've seen one card, but I don't know. It'd be nice to see also Intel coming into the playing field, but I don't think this year, be more next year.
Yeah, I mean, there were lots of interesting rumors that their GPU architecture was quite well scaled for servers and for video encoding. So it'll be very interesting to see, because I suppose that's the thing. You don't actually need super powerful GPU, like actual GPU muscle, to do video encoding.
No, you don't need any of the 3D business.
You just need the specialized hardware. So it's possible that actually, even if, because just the lack of like time and sort of experience in the space, it could be that even if their GPUs don't perform nearly as well as Nvidia or AMD's offerings, that actually, if they can really nail with their experience, already they've got lots of experience with their Intel's QuickSync, which is very good. I'm not exactly sure how it stacks up compared to NVENC.
I think it's a contender, though.
I think it's pretty similar, including even with the Turing generation. So including with the best generation of NVENC, I think it's pretty similar. So if they can try and nail that experience and put that fixed function hardware into their GPUs and put them at a good enough price and keep the drivers unlocked, they could be onto an absolute winning formula with people who have to work with video.
Yeah, I think...
Because they could just outprice Nvidia's their server offerings with just like some fixed function hardware and just see if that works.
Yeah, I think they're releasing free tiers, aren't they? For actual.
So
GPU.
I've heard. I've got a bit out of the loop with the whole Intel with like the whole sort of Intel GPU thing. So I'm not exactly sure where we are. I'm just looking to try and see what's going on with Nvidia's server.
And it's also one thing as well, is that they actually, well, they don't put a hard code, well, they don't limit the amount of streams you can transcode. Unlike, well, at least with QSV, so that's another good selling.
Oh, do they not?
No.
That's the thing, because I haven't had a play with QSV yet. But yeah, that would be great. If they can put a powerful QSV unit and a cheap enough GPU... That's us sorted. That's any of our streaming computers, any of our transcoders. We don't need to buy the expensive Nvidia models.
Yeah, the issue is just they're still off, and also Intel, they've been a bit disastrous the past. Well, they've lost their footing a bit.
Yeah, it has. It's been an interesting year, actually. It's sort of how the mighty have fallen. It's all led up to this point, really. And it's just seemingly they've sort of. AMD have been catching up, certainly in the CPU division, for a hot while now, but they've never sort of quite been able to take every sort of like benchmark and win from Intel. Mm. But then recently with this latest generation, because the single core performance has gotten so good, they can even like sort of take those gaming titles that Nvidia sort of previously had been just unbeatable at. So yeah, it's very, very interesting. To be honest, I can't wait to see what happens. So I'm very excited to see what happens with Intel's GPUs. Obviously, Intel's going to be releasing some CPUs with the whole sort of big little architecture.
Yeah, it was kind like of the laptops, copying, though,
wasn't it? Yes, kind of copying sort of the what typically people have done with ARM CPUs. Certainly, Apple's been doing for ages with their sort of big little stuff in their phones, and now with the M1 chip.
It's also like the AMD APUs, if you're familiar with those.
Yeah, I'm not as well versed with any of the AMD stuff.
Yeah,
that's it'll be interesting to see what happens there. I'm just trying to keep an eye on what is the total number of concurrent sessions. Yeah, I think across their entire consumer range, it's three.
Three, is it? Also, this is actually really weird. You know how like my feed keeps on dying for you, sort of. Essentially, you turn into like some disco thing where you turn multicolor.
Excellent.
But what happened is I'm looking at my CPU and the video decode, it just jumps up to like 100%. But when it's fine, video decode's like 4%. So I'm not too sure what on earth you're sending me. Is it VP9 you're still sending me?
I've literally no idea. I didn't bother to configure it that much.
So it's very peculiar, but yeah.
I think it was right, because I was looking to see what Quadro cards it was. It was the Quadro P2000 was sort of the first one where it was like, okay, that's sort of the cheapest Quadro where you have unrestricted numbers of NVENC sessions. And that starts at £400, but I don't know if they've actually really updated that, because that was obviously Pascal generation, which is still still a hot while back. So they've got seemingly a T2000. What's the price on one of those?
And also, I think they're getting rid of their workstation line to an extent. I remember hearing they're going to merge, just the different product lines, just so they have like the enterprise and then you have like the consumer line.
Yeah. Interesting. Seemingly they've switched, because the 2000 sort of series was for desktop as well, but seemingly.
Could we see the screen perhaps?
I'm just trying to have a look first before I do that. So right now I'm looking at, there we go. So this is NVIDIA's website with...
is it the Matrix, is it?
Yeah, it's their Matrix. They've changed it slightly, so it's a bit easier to navigate, because there were some very weird hidden things before, which was a bit of a pain to try and get around.
They've updated it, have they?
Yeah, but obviously, yeah, you can see here, so that... This P2000 used to be sort of, it was the cheapest sort of unrestricted, like, latest generation one. Mm. And that was about £400, and, yeah, had an unrestricted number of of NVENC sessions, and it was quite useful like that. But obviously, sort of, that was still built upon the Pascal architecture. So ultimately, we wanted to try and get something that was sort of, like, more Turing-based, and... they don't really seem to have replaced it, because looking across their entire Turing like range, if you have a look here, all of them are built for mobile. The only two that aren't are the RTX 4000 series and above. And how much is one of those?
Imagine it'll be a pretty penny.
Currently looking at about £700 to about £1,000.
Yeah,
which is loads. Like, what?
They just make such a markup on just the enterprise use. I mean, they've got the money to spare, obviously, but it's not good for us.
Yeah, so that's the thing. So that's why I'm very happy to switch to Intel QuickSync if they can provide us with a decent GPU. Forget that. Not even a decent GPU, a decent encoder. That's all we need.
Mm.
because obviously we'll need to stick with typical GPUs for all of our video editing workstations and our graphics workstations. But anything, any of our transcoders or any of our stream boxes, we could just switch over like that, and it'd be great if they can give us something that's cheap enough. Right, now, Reese, do you want to fill some time for about a minute whilst I grab a drink because my throat is hurting?
Yes.
This is Reese Fills Time.
So, we're going to move on from the fantastic GPUs, and we're going to talk about a bit of Blackmagic, because they have been a little bit more busy than you might think. If you don't know Blackmagic, they are just, like, quite a nice budget, and they're quite innovative, shall I say, as a video or broadcast engineering business. So yeah, what they've recently announced is, well, they've got a new update for their Blackmagic video assists. So video assists, if you didn't know, they're literally, you take the HDMI out from your camera or an SDI out from your camera, connect it into that camera, and it allows you to record in ProRes. Hello, Benjamin, again.
Yeah, I'm back. Hello.
Yes, I'm talking about Blackmagic's update for the video assists, but I'm just explaining what video assists are.
Oh, yes. Right.
Yes. So the video assists now, they've got fantastic functionality where you can record in ProRes, whilst your camera might only be able to encode at like H.264 30 megabits, when instead you could have this dedicated encoder and you can just record ProRes, which could be 100 megabits a second, or I'm not too sure. How far does ProRes go up to? 300 megabits a second?
Beyond that, I think it depends exactly which standard ProRes you're going
for.
Yeah,
and if you want like full 10-bit color or something like that. But no, it's fantastic bit of kit. And recently, they've just announced a little update allowing to literally just plug into your computer and use it as a webcam as well, which is fantastic, especially for these COVID secure times. I actually try and pinch on for these shows, actually. I've actually debated whether to buy one personally, but it's also I just wouldn't have much use for it as well. But they're just fantastic as portable screens because they're battery powered. You can hot swap them. They're just brilliant on the go.
I will say I'm not a huge fan of how Reese's, when he's been performing server operations before, just plugged in a video assist and used it as a portable monitor. I really don't like that.
It's brilliant as a portable monitor. I'm not sure what the resolution on it is, but it's minimum 1080p. It's such a dense screen. It's fantastic. Literally. I mean,
right, so you asked a question earlier about ProRes. So if you go up to effectively 5K resolution at 50 frames a second, ProRes 4444 XQ, I'm trying to think what's
the bitrate push in there.
So I think that's, is that 10 bit? No, that would be 12. No, I think that would be 12 bit. I think that's 12 bit color. Then the maximum bit rate for that is 4 gigabit a second.
Jeez Louise, is that push in the boat?
Yeah, that's it. ProRes gets challenging real quick, but that's why it's such a flexible format, because you can fit enough data in there for it to be useful for stuff like right the way up the sort of, I suppose, quality food chain.
Yeah, it's fantastic industry standard, especially if you've got large file store and you're editing.
Yeah, I mean, I'm still quite a big fan of GoPro Cineform codec. That seems to work quite nicely. It's nice and speedy to encode as well.
Interesting. I haven't really looked into their codec, but
it's a less popular mezzanine format. That's from what I can tell. But I think they've used it over at Linus Tech Tips before. I think.
Really?
Yeah.
But just like their exports, or just what they record at?
I think it's less of a recording one. It's more of a true sort of mezzanine type thing. So that's once you've actually ingested stuff, and sort of when you export it. But I believe that's where I heard of it from. I think, but I might have got that wrong. Somewhere on YouTube, though. But yeah, no, it's jolly neat. It's interestingly, it's GPU accelerated.
Cineform.
That's kind of its standout feature, I suppose, compared to either DNxHD, which is Avid's thing, or ProRes, which is Apple's thing. So those are the two sort of like big players, I suppose, in the mezzanine format sort of world. But you know, it's interesting. Oh, Mark Polakovs has entered the chat.
Ding.
Oh, I'm so happy about that.
That's trouble.
Abused for my speech patterns by all the radio people, as per usual.
Oh no, was it posted in URY? We've got 8 viewers. Oh no.
Oh yeah, no, it's going up.
It's terrible. People can see how low.
Jacob Dick says this is life changing content. Thank you, Jacob. Hello. Jacob will be gutted to find out that we just finished our discussion about QuickSync and NVENC. So, because I know he's a big fan of all the GPU encoding stuff, particularly the QuickSync stuff.
Hey, geez, Louise.
There's some spicy messages appearing in the YouTube comment section.
Sadly, we do not have an OnlyFans, but if we could set one up.
I'm shutting that idea down now.
The thing that we could buy with it, though, we could get plenty of Dell monitors. Oh, nice 27-inch open shot.
You've got to offer me more than Dell monitors, I'm afraid. It's going to be more than that on the line. That reminds me. So Marx has stolen a laptop to try and start preparing for the URY sort of like charity stream that's happening on Sunday. But apparently there have been some interesting stability issues with OBS and Casper. So Casper is a broadcast like graphics platform that's sort of used kind of in a variety of different TV stations, but we also use it here at Wise TV. Apparently there are some fun random CPU spikes. So he's now kind of just sort of given up on the whole Windows thing. He's just trying to install Ubuntu Studio and try and do everything in Linux.
Oh, it's Ubuntu Studio as well.
Yeah.
Get those installed on our machines because I prefer Linux to Windows right now.
I mean, I think keeping things at Windows for now would just be beneficial just for general users.
But it's just have it dual boot and default to Linux. Not default to Linux, sorry. Default to Windows.
It was a 50-50 there. You got it wrong, but...
Well, at least I can actually get a dual boot to work. This is one thing which I can succeed at.
I can get dual boots to work if the Nvidia drivers on Linux actually worked nicely. And my laptop does now work on Linux. Jacob says in the comments, "I heart GPU," and yes, I know he does. We've had many a long, extensive discussion about preferred encoders and stuff like that. Yes, Linux's Nvidia drivers was an interesting situation. I tried to dual boot my laptop to Linux, and it's one of the ones with an integrated Nvidia GPU as well as an Intel sort of like discrete thing. A discrete Nvidia GPU as well as an Intel integrated one. Once I'd installed it, it just booted to a black screen because the Nvidia drivers just didn't work until I sort of added another like 16 flags or something ridiculous.
At least it took room to work. That's impressive. But...
Yes, and I did get the Wi-Fi to work first time around, so
no say what you will.
All right, goodbye URY people. Enjoy the rest of engineering meeting. I might catch you over there after this is over. People still hanging about.
I'm blocking that, aren't I? Oh, man.
Yes. Oh, at this point, it's not engineering meeting so much as the engineering social. I wonder how they found out that this was a thing. What happened?
They might be subscribed to our YouTube channel, perhaps.
Oh, God forbid anyone subscribe to our YouTube channel.
Forbid.
I wish we could do more stuff on YouTube rather than on Facebook.
Yeah, I mean, YouTube's decent as a platform, but I still prefer our own self-hosted.
Yeah, doing our own self-hosted stuff is great in terms of like learning lessons about computing and sort of distributed systems and stuff like that. I don't think we should stop that anytime soon. Just for the sheer amount of stuff you can learn, it's great. Mm. But obviously,
especially for any
in terms of for any video platforms, I don't know. It just seems like whenever we try and do anything on Facebook, it always feels like more of a faff than whenever we try and do anything on YouTube.
Yeah. So. Also, for Peony, I plan on going back next month. Date, not too sure, I'm going to be honest. Also, we have a villain in the chat. Michael, you can give me a UOI show and I might consider it. Right, put you...
We deleted all the messages.
I clicked a timeout, I think. So I'm not sure if he's in the naughty corner.
Oh, excellent. Oh, that is the single best invention in the entirety of YouTube.
There we go, we're fighting back.
Oh, let's not start a media war again. Hello, Keone.
Bit of Castle Ned. We do approve of Castle Ned. I think I'm probably mispronouncing that as well. Good to see I'm very good at pronouncing Welsh places.
Interesting. Okay. Oh, dear. Have you got any other topics? Because this is now just turned into a right rambling for about an hour.
Yes, I did have one final topic, I think. Or did we discuss? Oh, no, I think we might have finished discussing that. Darn, so I've actually run out of topics.
Run out of topics? Ooh.
Which is, I mean, I can talk about some other things I pick offline, but I think next time we'll actually get a dedicated list of curated content.
Yes, it'll be good to be slightly more prepared with this whole thing. Yeah, just talking about the general world of video tech and that sort of nerdy stuff. Is this going to be a weekly thing? I really don't know.
We could do it bi-weekly, I think, without ruining our degrees.
Yeah, possibly.
I mean, it's not that difficult to produce.
Yeah.
I mean, the fact that the amount of research that went into this was 10 minutes before.
It was 10 minutes where you should have been prepared with stuff.
It's just... Sleep is atrocious. It's the villain.
Yes, well, we'll need to see, because, I mean, most of the time it should be on a Thursday, but we had other events stopping us from doing that, so what can you do?
So, just to clarify, I'm not bi. Ben might be. I don't know. I haven't asked him.
I don't even know how to respond to these comments, Keone. I'm at a loss. I'm at a loss.
But we'll see how much content we do. We try minimum produce bi-weekly, shall we?
Oh, Jacob's back. Oh, I think we're about to wrap things up, Jacob, I'm afraid.
Oh, unless you can post any things in the comments. Reese is Bay. Thank you.
Yes. Actually, yeah, why not? Let's open this up to the audience of mostly radio people. Is there anything about video that you'd like us to discuss? Anything video related that's PG? Because I already know people are going to suggest OnlyFans. Let's not stay away from that. No, stop it. Anything interesting and video related? Oh, some detail. 2021-10 versus NDI. Interesting.
There's a good website that says SMTP, it sucks and recommends NDI, but still, I can complain about NDI. Do you want to give a brief overview first, Ben, of both of them?
Oh, dear. Right. So, I'm just double checking. So, from memory, just to try and give some context to people. So this is just off the top of my head, so this might not be perfectly accurate, but I think it's close enough. So SMPTE 2110 is effectively, it's a way of trying to send uncompressed video. So stuff that you'd normally get on an SDI cable, which is kind of like sort of your HDMI cables, but it's a slightly different standard. It's close enough to sort of the HDMI cables that you plug into your TV in terms of like, well, it's just pretty much just raw video data. So it's this huge, like multiple gigabits a second worth of video data. Which obviously is quite, with most people's internet connections and stuff, it's quite tricky
it's
to
not
do
even
whatever.
Just internet connections, it's like local networks as well.
Yeah. So the point was, rather than send this over an SDI cable, because more things are sort of in studio environments switching to video over IP and sort of video over sort of Ethernet cables. That was supposed to be a protocol for being able to send SDI levels of data across and over an IP connection. So you need like a 10 gigabit network or something ridiculous. It's basically the issue that people have is that the throughput levels are so ridiculous that it's almost impossible to implement, I think.
Especially on a budget right now. Especially.
Yeah, especially on a budget. But there are also all sorts of other different issues with the standards. So a lot of the time now, people are just switching to trying to use NDI instead, which is a much more closed box solution because it's a black box that Mutex sort of have devised. It's incredibly useful. It does have some advantages and disadvantages, but it is compressed technically, but it's kind of the quality is good enough that for most people it doesn't really matter. Even like sort of big broadcasts are using this. So that's kind of where that's got to. So 7021.10, it's, I think part of the issue is just the fact that because of the hardware limitations and the sheer amount of hardware that you need to actually like use it, it's not particularly useful unless you're at the ridiculously high end. So yeah, personally, I'm a bigger fan of NDI in terms of sending video like point to point, where you don't have to use sort of any of the sort of things about NDI that kind of make it good, but also like a bit weird and different to most normal sending protocols. Currently, we stick with sort of something that's close enough to SMPTE's 2022 sort of spec for video over IP, which is pretty much just shove everything in an MPEG TS and an MPEG transport stream.
I think it's FLV we're still using right now.
It depends. So yeah, we use FLV for any of our RTMP stuff, but SRT sort of over the time, and that's effectively using this damn 2022 standard because that's shove everything into an MPEG transport stream and sort of fart it out over a network.
Yeah, like so. 21.10, that is 21.10. Yeah, that's just RTP, so it hasn't also got some of the advantages as well of like these other protocols like SRT or NDI where it can handle the network loss.
Yes, that is the advantage of SRT, I suppose, compared to something like RTP. Unless you've got like really fancy signaling stuff, there's a lot more sort of built-in stuff for packet loss and retransmission because they're based on, under the hood, they're both based on the UDP protocol.
Yes, and also one thing I could also comment on is also NDI. It uses this thing called, as far as I'm aware, it uses this thing called Speed HQ underneath the hood, which is like unlike 2110, which is literally just raw video data. Speed HQ is like ProRes, where it's a mezzanine, but it's just still got some compression. But it's like it balances it, so it only needs to do 100 megabits instead of 6 gigabits, for example. Also, to go through the comments here, radio sucks. I can't say much on that, can I? What are we drinking? I actually do need to get a drink, but what about you, Ben?
I'm just on orange and pineapple squash. I do have my Radio Techcom provided can of lager, but I haven't tucked into that yet, so we'll need to wait for that. Nice.
And also, Michael says that I can do a UOI show, so the 11:37 PM show is a go then, but looks like...
I don't think he necessarily agreed to your ridiculous timing, but we'll need to see.
Terrible. I think it's a perfect time. Always catch on BBC iPlayer. I've been enjoying BBC iPlayer a lot recently. Been watching His Dark Materials and Doctor Who. A lot of fun, but yeah.
Interesting.
But to go back onto the NDI versus 2110, I think I prefer SRT over them all right now. It's also, it's still early days with it. This is also another issue.
It depends, because honestly, on a local studio network, NDI is absolutely fabulous. It's such a useful standard for just if you have multiple machines within like a studio, and if say you want to send graphics, because that's another advantage of NDI. It has alpha channel support sort of natively baked in.
Well, that's pretty good.
So that's how we do stuff like Casper currently on things. Where if we're not doing it sort of over like sort of SDI connections with like sort of separate alpha channels and like much more sort of complex setups like that, we can just ping it from NDI from the graphics machine to our sort of video mixing station just over NDI, and that includes the alpha and everything like that. It's lovely. So yeah, in terms of actual proper transmission from point to point or from like client to server, 2022 is still useful. That's probably
it's like
my
if
preferred
it's
thing.
Fixed infrastructure as well, just like transcoders or just your CDN.
Yeah. I think the biggest issue with 2110 is that at the moment it's really quite cost prohibitive and there isn't really a use case where it makes a huge amount of sense unless you're in a very, very specific environment where you have to have perfect uncompressed video.
I think
if most of the time you don't.
If you got the money as well. As well. Ooh, HEVC. Proprietary though. Well, I mean, funny AV1 finally got there. I mean, it's getting there.
Eventually. It'll eventually get there. And yeah, I suppose it. It's kind of going to be up to Intel and AMD, I suppose, to actually try and put the decoding sort of built into their CPUs. It'll be interesting to see when we get our first proper native encoders for AV1.
Yes, it'll be nice to see them. There's probably already some like dedicated hardware, like FPGAs, but obviously very cost prohibitive. Right.
Who
there.
Is currently logged into the York Student Television account who's just commented MJPEG?
Might be me. Honestly, what about this? MJPEG over WebSockets, which have been base64 encoded.
I am very much not a fan of MJPEG because... I think it's effectively, according to most studies, like the JPEG sort of... JPEG's effective image quality, if you set like sort of GOP size to 1, is like considerably worse than H.264. I think to get an equivalent-ish image compression quality to H.264, you have to go to JPEG 2000, which is why I don't like MJPEG, because it uses that older standard. That's the thing, but it's a case of things are already moving on from H.264, so the fact that MJPEG is like even like ever used, I'm not really a fan of, because it's sort of it's a worse encoding quality typically than a standard that we're already moving away from.
Yeah, for MJPEG now or JPEG 2000.
JPEG 2000 is still okay to use if in a pinch.
Yeah, like, I think that's what they use in industry as well.
Yes, the JPEG 2000 is what they currently use in DCP, which is sort of how you serve movies to cinemas. It's a JPEG 2000 stream. Isaac Grove in the chat saying that he sends back rolls of 35mm film to the studio, ready for projection. Excellent.
I'm not too sure on the latency of that, I'm going to be honest. It's not what we're aiming for.
So the latency will be directly proportional to the distance from like your broadcast location, because effectively you just need a single strip of 35mm film back to whichever location.
Oh, that's sketchy and also so expensive. Imagine how much it costs encode that.
Oh, it would cost so much, but at the same time, I really want to do it because that sounds like so much fun.
Oh dear.
Oh,
well, so also we've been doing some testing as well of SRT.
Yes, a mixture of that's it. Because at the moment, for a while now at YCV, we've been stuck on the very sort of standard RTMP for transmission and then HLS for serving video. And with sort of the way that things are changing nowadays, we're trying to sort of move on to effectively the next generation of things. So we're trying to now change our transmission protocol to be primarily SRT. And then for our delivery protocols, we're investigating a lot of stuff to do with CMAF, which is the Common Media Application Format, I think is the acronym, but I can't remember it off my head. And then we're trying to... Because that is potentially interchangeable media between both Dash manifests and HLS manifests, we're going to see if we can try and support both. And more interestingly, we're going to see if whenever we make our next transition, we're going to see if we can support low latency Dash and HLS, which is going to be very interesting. So, yeah. Obviously, that whole project hasn't been helped by the fact that Apple's been sort of going around changing the low latency HLS spec, so there isn't really a huge amount of adoption for their finalized thing, because they finalized it in, I think, July of this year at WWDC, because it had been in beta for the spec had been in beta for a previous year, and they changed quite a few things, significant things, to how they'd initially sort of put things out. So the open source community sort of hasn't really been able to properly catch up and sort of support it yet. So we'll need to see what happens with that.
But at least there's still Dash, though.
Yeah, certainly Dash has been around for quite a while longer. The low latency Dash standard has been around, I think, since 2016 or something.
Jeez, they've been out of the game.
Or maybe that was just CMAF support for Dash.
Quite possibly.
It's been around for several years either way. And we've been doing some testing with that, so using SRT and Dash, and low latency Dash specifically, and I managed to get a glass-to-glass effectively of a glass-to-glass latency of about, I think, 3 seconds.
Was that on an off-site server as well?
No, this was just locally. So this was also using, for the first time in our like video serving platform, it was using NVENC rather than CPU encoding for actually sort of resizing all the different formats. So that was the first time we've ever really put everything together. I sort of set up a little test stream. So that was going from OBS, SRT, up to our SRT server, then getting pulled down to the computer that I was on, which was then acting as an encoder, pulling it down on SRT, using GPU encoding to quickly create three different resolutions and bit rates, and then serve it in low latency Dash to the computer that I was watching on. And that was about 3 seconds. And it was very nice, because usually with typical things like HLS and sort of the standards that we've been going with before, latency sort of ranges anywhere from like 12 seconds if you're nice and speedy to like 45 seconds or like a minute.
Yeah, it does tend to vary a bit. I mean, my little test there as well, I was able to get literally sub-second as well. Obviously, I didn't have SRT there, but still.
That's the thing. I think the up-down, technically, by the time you allow for a little bit of buffering, I think usually takes about 2 seconds-ish.
Mm. But we need to actually get it deployed on our own infrastructure.
And I was using a different server application to you to actually take the CMAF files and send them out, so...
Yeah,
it'll be interesting to see, because you've now sent me the link to that. I'm going to try and perform the same tests with the scripts that I'd put together and see exactly what happens with that.
Mm.
But that's going to be for later. But certainly, yeah, the whole delivery. I never thought I'd find video delivery interesting. But again, it's like with GPUs, we're at a very interesting point in 2020 where things are all sort of kicking off at the moment.
Indeed. We've also got a comment from Michael Grace here. It says he's got the opinion about front-end interfaces, and it applies to you too. Pure plain text interfaces, no graphics. I'm pretty sure the only proper way, I say pretty sure. So, very much pushing plain text as an option here. I mean, this stream is kind of plain text in a way. The only graphics is text.
Not a fan of pushing plain text video, personally. Don't know about you.
Just do it on a web sock, and we're fine.
Not entirely convinced, but okay. Right. We've now been going for about an hour and 20 minutes, so I feel like we should wrap this up.
Yes, I think that's a good idea.
Right.
Yeah,
I think tune in next time for whatever the hell we've done since then. More general discussions about the world of technical video. Will Search just entered the chat, but I'm afraid we're wrapping up, sadly.
It'll be available video on demand.
Yes, it will be available to rewatch, both on the YSTV website and on YouTube, fingers crossed, although no promises.
Oh, are you recording on OBS?
Absolutely not. I hadn't thought of that.
So a bit of YouTube DL on this bad boy from the looks of it.
We don't need to YouTube DL it. We can just download videos from Creator Studio.
Oh, of course, yes. That's only if you're not the content creator.
Exactly. Right. So yeah, tune in next time for whatever we actually end up doing since then, just more general discussions about the world of technical video, something that we don't necessarily know a huge amount about, but we certainly try.
Yeah, we pretend to.
Right, do you want to say your goodbyes, Reese?
Yes, au revoir, and also Sturkey, I will tidy up. It's just the OB unit that's making it look messy. That's all that it is.
The thing is, I've got a bigger OB unit in my room, I'm just better at hiding it, so...
Yeah, but I was tired, and I was trying to actually get it to work, but sadly it didn't. But yeah, that is an au revoir from me.
Right, thank you very much for watching, we'll see you next time, goodbye.